So hello and welcome friends to our channel Intromech, and we have started discussing about the metal forming processes, and today we are going to discuss about the rolling process in which a material sheet is compressed between the two rotating rollers such that its thickness is reduced. We can see here H0 or HO is the original height of the strip, and H1 is the final thickness of the strip. Okay, so let's see what are the terminologies here. So here we have HO is the original thickness of the strip. Say H1 is the thickness after rolling. After the rolling process, the thickness is H1. Then V0 is the entry velocity, we can say, entry velocity at which the strip is fitting to these rollers. Then V1 is the exit velocity of the strip. Okay, now we have here the rollers which are rotating, and again there is a alpha which is called as deformation or bite angle, or it's called as bite angle. Okay, so the rollers are rotating and the strip is fed towards this rotating roller, and it gets compressed between this rollers. Now these two rollers should rotate at the same velocity so that it can be pulled properly. So this is our top roller and this is our bottom roller. So the velocity of the top roller should be equal to the velocity of bottom roller. This is the surface velocity of the rollers, so it can be calculated as pi into diameter of the roller into n of the top rotational speed divided by 60, okay, of top, and same pi dn by 60 of the bottom. So as we can see, the diameter of the two rollers should be same, otherwise there will not be uniform thickness reduction. So D will be same, so what we get is the top roller should have the same velocity as the bottom roller. So let's consider V is the surface velocity of the rollers, okay, and we have delta H, that is nothing but the reduction in the thickness of the strip, which is H original minus H1, so that will be our delta H. Now we have a friction between these rollers and a strip, and without the friction it cannot be drawn. So mu is the coefficient of friction, say, between the strip and the roller. So it will be dependent on the material of the strip and the material of the roller. So between strip and roller, okay, then there will be the friction angle, which is beta. So we know that mu is nothing but the tan beta, so beta is the friction angle. So all these factors we have, and let's analyze these parameters. Okay, so for this rolling process we have to do some assumptions, like it is based on some assumptions. So the first assumptions we can say is that the material is incompressible. What does it mean is that the delta V, the volume change, is same. Whatever the material is coming to the rollers, the same material is going outwards. That means the change in volume is zero. So the delta V will be zero. Whatever material is coming, the same material is going outwards. Now here what we are assuming is that the say B0 is the original width and B1 is the width of strip after the deformation. So we are considering the B0 is equal to B1. What does it mean is that whatever deformation is happening in the thickness, it's reflecting in the length of the strip. So the thickness is reducing and the length of the strip is increasing. Okay, assuming the width of the strip is constant. So this is the assumption. So with this assumption, if we consider like the strip is flowing, so if we consider the flow rate entering and the flow rate outgoing is same, so we have the B is constant, so what we have is H0. Okay, so we have H0, which is the original thickness. Then we have a B0, and then we have the velocity original, and then we have H1, then B1 into V1. So as we know, we have considered B0 and B1 are same, so what we can have is H0 by H1 is equal to V1 by V0. So it is clear that, you know, the V1 is obviously greater than V1 is greater than V0. So the velocity of the strip is increasing. Okay, so as it is passing through the rollers, the velocity is increasing. Now we have seen the parameters, different parameters. So let's just see once again the parameters which we have seen. Now in this case, what we are assuming that A is the entry point where the strip is entering to the rollers, and B is the exit point. Now the region between this entry and exit is divided into two regions. The first region is called as the lagging region. This is a neutral pin, and the region between the neutral point and the exit point is called as a leading zone. Now how we can analyze these zones? So let's see. Now we have, as we said, we have two regions. Let's say strip is coming like here. Okay, so we have two regions. So this is our entry point, this is our exit point, right? So we have this one as our lagging zone and two as our leading zone. Okay, so these are our two zones. Now the material is entering with velocity V. Okay, so when the strip is entering with velocity V, the rollers are also rotating with velocity, surface velocity V. Now this V0 is lesser than the velocity of the rollers, and because of that the rollers are pulling the strip towards it. Now when this material is touching the rollers, when it entering into the leading zone, its velocity starts increasing. Okay, so the relative velocity, that means the velocity of the roller and the velocity of the strip, is started reducing. Why? Because as the material enters here, its velocity start increasing as its area is reducing, so its velocity is increasing. But the roller velocity is constant because it has the same dia and the roller speed is same, so its surface velocity, which is V, is constant. So here in this lagging zone, we have the first the velocity of the strip is, you know, started increasing, and because of the which the relative velocity is reduces. Now at the neutral point, the velocity of the strip becomes equal to the velocity of roller, and that's why the relative velocity becomes zero. Now after this zone, the velocity of the strip again starts increasing, and now this velocity is greater than the velocity of the rollers. That means the relative velocity is again increased, but in opposite direction, because here the velocity of the strip was lesser than the velocity of roller, but here the velocity of strip is greater than the velocity of the roller. That's why the relative velocity again start increasing in opposite direction. So we have slip, that means the velocity is different. Now this slip of the strip is directly proportional to the relative velocity, okay, which we have seen right now. Now as we have seen that in the lagging zone, the inlet velocity is larger than the roller velocity, so this is called as lagging slip, or it is called as backward slip. So backward slip is in the lagging zone, and in lagging zone V naught is greater than velocity of the roller, so that's why it is called as backward slip. Now in the leading zone, we have a forward slip, and in this case we have seen the velocity of strip is greater than the velocity of the roller, and that's why here we have seen that the velocity of strip is lesser than the velocity of a roller, so it must be V minus V naught by V. So that's my mistake, because we have seen the roller velocity is higher in this case, and in this case the strip velocity is higher. Now this difference and this difference is not same. That means the maximum difference in velocity at the entry and the maximum velocity difference at the exit is not same. These two are different. Okay, so what we can say is that if V naught is our initial velocity, so the maximum relative velocity will be V minus V naught. Okay, this will be at entry, and at exit it will be V minus V. So this is the relative velocity maximum, say at the entry, and this is at exit. Okay, this is at entry. So these two values are not equal. These are different. They are not same. So this is the slip which is acting in this rolling process, and this is a simple physics which we have to understand as the velocity here and the velocity here and the roller velocity. So it is the relation between these three velocities, and on this velocity differences there is a slip because of this relative velocity, and on this slip the pressure variation is dependent. Now this pressure variation which is generated, this pressure is inversely proportional to the slip. So now this is important, as we have seen the slip is proportional to the relative velocity, and the pressure is inversely proportional to slip. That means it is inversely proportional to the relative velocity. So now in the this lagging region, we have seen that the relative velocity is reducing, okay, because the strip velocity is increasing and the roller velocity is constant, so our relative velocity is decreasing, And because of that, in case of our lagging region, the pressure is increasing, right? And in our leading zone, as we see, the slip is increasing, and because of that, the pressure is reducing. So this is another very important thing. Like in lagging zone, the pressure is increasing, and in the leading zone, the pressure is reducing. So we have seen how it is dependent on the slip, and what is slip, and how this velocity is changing, and how it is affecting. So these factors are very important, and how it affects the pressure. So it is a simple logic, and I hope you understood this, because this is very important. Just try to focus on the velocities of these three zones, and simply keep in mind how this area is reducing. So velocity is increasing, so initial velocity of the strip will be obviously lesser than the exit velocity, and the roller velocity should be constant. And as the area of the strip is changing in this zone, that's why the velocity is also changing, and that's why there is a relative velocity, and this relative velocity is related to slip, and that's why we have a lagging zone and leading zone, and we have a backward slip and forward slip, and this leads to the pressure variations. So like this, you can interconnect these phenomena, these parameters, and that's how you can keep these things in mind. You don't have to mug up these things, but you can go from the basics and you can keep these things in mind. So moving on to some basic relations which are required to calculate some things. Now I'm not going into the derivation part of this thing. So here we have seen delta H. It is nothing but the reduction which we are getting into this rolling process, which is nothing but a output parameter which we are expecting from this process. So this is delta H, and this delta H is nothing but the reduction in thickness. Okay, this is reduction in thickness, and it can be found out from the diameter of the roller and alpha, which is the bite angle which we have seen. Then L is nothing but the length of the strip, which we can find out, as this is a important parameter, how we can find out the L, because from that we have to link it to the force which we are calculating. So this L is equal to the radius of the roller into the delta H. So the these parameters can also be related as tan alpha is equal to delta H divided by R. Now the thing is, with this rolling parameter, it can be asked that how much maximum thickness reduction is possible, because there are factors on which this reduction is dependent. There is a friction between the roller and the strip, and there is a bite angle. So there is this angles should be maintained properly so that the material can be pulled and the thickness can be reduced. So there is a thing that delta H maximum is equal to mu square into R. This much maximum reduction in thickness we can achieve. And the thing is, now how much power, finally it is always required that how much power is required to carry out this rolling process. because it is related to your selection of say the rollers, the motor speed, the input drive which you are giving to the rollers. So how much power is required to carry out this process? So for that thing, this force is required to be carried out. Now force I have written here as average, because the thickness of the strip is varying. So that's why this force is average force, and it can be calculated as 2 by root 3 into yield strength of the material into width into this L. Width is constant, L we can calculate from this, into 1 plus mu is the coefficient of friction into this L divided by 4H. Now this H is the average thickness, and so this H is nothing but H naught plus H1 by 2. So you have to keep this in mind that this H is average because we are calculating the average force. So this is important thing. And now this is the average force, but if we see the rolling operation, the rollers are applying the force. Okay, they are applying the force on the strip, because of which the strip is getting deformed. But at the same time, the strip is applying a reaction on these rollers, which is nothing but equal and opposite to this average force. So this average force is also called as roll separating force, because it tries to separate these rollers, that it tries to push these rollers away from the strip. So that's why this F average is also called as roll separating force. That is roll separating force. Okay, so this is also important thing that you should know, what is the roll separating force. It is nothing but this force or is a reaction which is offered by the strip on the rollers. So it is called as roll separating force. And the roll separating distance, now what will be the roll separating distance? So it's again a little bit logical thing. If we say roll separating distance, I have this radius, then this thickness, and this radius again. So I have the like R plus R, okay, then plus this H, 1, okay. So this is nothing but the roll separating distance, we can say. And it is also important thing, the roll separating distance. Sometimes it is asked that what is the roll separating distance and roll separating force. So this by this, or again we can write it as d plus h1. So it is a roller diameter into your plus your exit thickness, which is the final thickness of the material. So this is your roll separating distance. Now in order to have a reduction in power, the aim of the process is always we should require a minimum power to carry out the process. Now in order to carry out the process in minimum power, the force required for the process should be minimum. Now if you observe this thing, it is dependent on the yield strength, then coefficient of friction, then this L. So how we can reduce this force is, first we can achieve it by reducing the sigma y, or then the second thing, we can reduce the coefficient of friction. But as I said, this coefficient of friction we cannot reduce to a very low value, because the strip then cannot get pulled between the rollers. So the minimum value to which we can reduce this mu is the bite angle is equal to the friction angle. So this is the minimum thing. So from this beta we can have a tan beta is nothing but mu, but this beta can be reduced up to the bite angle of the bite angle of the roller only. So this is the thing. And again, we have a L. So L can, here we can see L is dependent on R, which R is nothing but the roller radius. So R is a roller radius. So if we want to reduce the L, we have to reduce the R. Now, so we have to reduce the roller radius. But again, if we reduce the roller radius to a very less extent, it cannot apply the pressure, or it may get deformed because of the excessive reaction forces. So we have to keep this value within the limit. So what we can do is we can reduce the radius of this roller, and in order to have it the rigidity, we can apply the supporting rollers. So this is the thing which is carried out to reduce the force, and by reducing the roller radius and by giving the supporting rollers. So by this method, we can reduce the average force which is required for the process, and by this we can reduce the power requirement. Okay, so these are all the parameters which are involved in this process. Now, another important thing which we will discuss here is, because of the roll separating force, what happens? Let's consider the rollers. Say this is my roller, okay, and the strip is in between, and this is my bottom roller. Okay, both will be same, sorry for the drawing. Okay, and they are like supported here. Okay, and this is our strip. Now this strip is applying reaction on these rollers, and this condition is considered as a simply supported beam with the UDL loading. Okay, it is applying reaction. So this condition is considered of the rollers as a simply supported beam, okay, with UDL. Okay, so because of this, there is deformation of the rollers because it is applying the reaction. So what will happen, this roller try to, you know, bulge like this, and the bottom roller will try to bulge like this. Now, because of this, what happens, my strip thickness should be like this, but what I am getting is like this. Okay, so this is T, this is T, but here I am getting another T1, so which is larger than T. So I am not getting uniform thickness in this case, and this is not at all required. I always want a uniform thickness of the material. So this is something we can say error in the process, and in order to remove this, cambering is done. What does it mean is, you are initially giving the shape to rollers like, so if I initially made my roller like, now it is getting deform, so I will make it like this. Okay, so initially only I will provide this is called as cambering. So I am intentionally making the shape of this roller like you know, convex shape. So I am making the rollers like this so that when the reaction is applied, the rollers get elastically deformed, and when they deform, they will come to this position, okay, and because of this my thickness will be uniform. My thickness will be uniform. This is what I want. So this is called as scambering process, or making the rollers as a convex shape, and this reduces the variation in the thickness of the material. So this is one terminology. So I hope I have tried to cover the all the parameters which are involved and the terminologies which are involved in the rolling process, and I hope you understood the concepts. And if you have any doubts, please do write into the comment section and we can discuss over there. And until then, stay home, stay happy. Thank you.